Good evening, I'm Leo Green, welcoming you to part two of my Hollywood special. And this time, not all of the stars are available for interview, for reasons which will become apparent. If you tuned in to part one on Christmas Eve, you'd have heard how my late father, Benny Green, was sent to Hollywood by the BBC in the mid-1970s. His brief was to conduct a series of interviews with some incredible Hollywood legends. The fruits of his trip, along with some existing BBC archives and interviews from various other sources, were then written up into a script for the actor Douglas Fairbanks Jr. to read. In part one, we heard from the likes of Fred Astaire, Gene Kelly and Bing Crosby. But in amongst the archive, I also found a series of interviews with Walt Disney and those involved with some of the most loved children's films of the 30s, 40s, 50s and 60s. Tonight, we turn our attention to those incredible movies from a golden era with some of the most endearing characters Hollywood has ever produced, including singing dogs.
He's a tramp. He's a scoundrel.
A singing, dancing, wisecracking bear.
I mean, bare necessities are Mother Nature's recipes that bring the bare necessities of life.
We'll hear from some flying elephants.
But I'll be done seeing about everything when I see an elephant. Fly.
Some jazz singing cats.
Everybody wants to be a cat, because a cat's the only cat who knows where is that hell.
And a yellow brick road and a certain rather well-known rodent. So, let's get started. Which film star could be classed as the biggest symbol of the Hollywood musical? Gene Kelly, perhaps? Judy Garland or Frank Sinatra? Well, the biggest star in the early to mid-20th century was in fact not human at all, but a small, squeaky thing. His name was Mickey Mouse. So how on earth did Walt Disney come up with what surely must be one of the biggest cultural contributions to the world any one individual has ever made? Well, there's two interviews from Benny's recordings that shed some light on that particular question. Here's Mr. Disney with one explanation of how Mickey came to be.
I was fumbling around with ideas for animated cartoons. Well, I always liked mice, and I used to watch their antics in my little old broken-down studio.
Who's the leader of the club that's made for you and me? M-I-C-K-E-Y-M-O-U-S-E.
Well, one of them seemed to have a distinct personality. He'd stroll about on my drawing board right under my nose. At first, I called him Mortimer Mouse. But that seemed too formal when we got to know one another. I abbreviated his name to Mickey.
Come along and sing the song and join the jamboree. M-I-C-K-E-Y-M-O-U-S-E.
Well, I suppose that does seem possible. The actual truth, I think, lies in this next interview segment, where Disney reveals that perhaps there might be an unsung hero in all this. On a train heading to a meeting in Hollywood, Disney has to come up with an idea to present to the studio bosses, and he rather likes the sound of a mouse called Mortimer.
Mickey came about 8 years after I'd been in the animated cartoon business. He was sort of a product of necessity, you see. I was in New York at the time, and I'd been producing a series of pictures for a company there. They were about a rabbit called Oswald the Rabbit. But I lost that. They took it away from me, so I was all alone. And Mrs. Disney and I were coming back from New York on the train, and I had to have something. I said, by the time I get to Hollywood, I must have something. I can't tell them I've lost Oswald. So I had this mouse in the back of my head, because a mouse is a sort of a sympathetic character, in spite of the fact that everybody's frightened of a mouse, including myself. So I had this mouse, and I tried it out with Mrs. Disney. I said, I'm going to have this little mouse. I'm going to call him Mortimer.
It's at this point of proceedings we meet the unsung hero I mentioned a minute ago. It would seem that Walt's wife Lillian did not like the name Mortimer and told her husband to come up with another one. I'll let Walt explain what Mrs. Disney thought. Now, husbands everywhere, take note.
And I said, what's the matter with Mortimer? And I got the usual answer back. I don't know, but I don't like it. So I was stuck. So, I mean, I have a little Irish blood in me. So sort of the euphony of Mickey and Mouse came to me. So I said, well, what about Mickey? Well, she says, I like that better. She didn't say it was good. She said, I like it better. So that was it.
So Walt, meanwhile, needed to find a voice for Mickey. And whilst explaining to studio bosses how he felt the mouse might speak, he inadvertently landed himself a job for life.
Well, it's just a falsetto, and we were fooling around and trying to get a voice for a mouse, and nobody knew what a mouse would sound like, so I said, well, it's kind of like this. And the guy said, well, why don't you do it? And I knew I'd always be on the payroll, so I did it.
Following his debut in 1928 with Steamboat Willie, Mickey's Hollywood career grew, and after establishing a companion for Mickey called Minnie, Disney soon realised he had endless possibilities for an entire population of cartoon animals.